Let's dissect the finance data. You need to know this Monday morning with the economics editor of the Australian Financial Review, John Keir. John, good morning to you. First up, households and businesses are being warned to brace for another jump in electricity prices.
Yeah, morning, guys. Look, it was only last month that energy regulators allowed big power price increases to kick in around the country. That included price rises of between 7 and 18% in New South Wales, Queensland and South Australia, 5% in Victoria, 12% in Tassie and only 2% in West Australia. But we're now being warned those price rises aren't going to be enough for the energy retailers to recoup their costs. So sometime over the next year, we're going to experience further significant increases in power prices. This is all being driven, of course, by the war in Ukraine, driving up energy prices and also some of those coal-fired power outages and just not enough renewables and battery storage in the system at the moment. And this is one of the reasons the Reserve Bank's warning that inflation's going to stay high next year as businesses pass on some of those costs to consumers as well.
You just wonder how much of that people can cop. But you do have some good news, though, on wages.
Yeah, good and bad news, Ali. It looks like wages growth is really going to start to pick up this year and next year. Survey by the Reserve Bank of Australia of businesses shows more than 60% now say they're going to pay wage increases of more than 3% this year. Wage growth over the next couple of years expected to go to between 3 and 4%. That'd be a decade high. The bad news, of course, is that because inflation's so high, real wages are actually going to be falling back to 2009 levels. And we're going to be going backwards in terms of real wages, which is inflation adjusted, until 2024. So yes, we'll see our dollars going up in our pay packet, but they won't be able to buy as much.
I've got a question for you. An interesting thing in your paper today, that 61% of your readers supported Nancy Pelosi going into Taiwan. I thought that was an interesting stat, given it's the equivalent of sending a Rottweiler to go get your tennis ball from next door. What do you think about that? Were you surprised by that?
What?
I love your terminology there, Carl.
Man.
I must admit, I was surprised 61% supported it because, I mean, just looking at some of the comments from Penny Wong, our Foreign Affairs Minister, and even the Shadow Defence Minister, Andrew Hastie, over the weekend, they were both circumspect about Pelosi's visit there, the House Speaker from the United States. They didn't actually say it was the wrong thing, but they certainly didn't support it.
It was weird.
Absolutely. I would have thought the figure would be low. I mean, I must admit, the Fin Review read, I don't think they typically particular big defence hawks or anything like that either. So I was a bit surprised.
Anyway, that's the thing that surprised me about the Fin Review this morning, among other things. I've been up since 11.
Nancy Pelosi is the Rottweiler. That's what I got out of it. Being very selective, aren't they, with what they're passing on?
Yeah, absolutely. So I wanted to see, well, how have they fared now that the August rate hike is out of the way? So we know we've had four hikes. 1.75 is what the cash rate's gone up. When you look at saving accounts, nowhere near that. Typically, you've got three types of saving accounts. You've got one that just gives you a base rate, no matter what you do, you get a flat rate. No love there. That's gone up by about 0.56 overall, all accounts. Bonus, they're the ones where you actually, if you adhere to the conditions, you get the extra rate. That's gone
up. Generous.
Yeah, that's really generous, 0.98. They've been focusing more on promo rates, what they call promotional rates, where you get 4 months of great rate, and that's where I've seen most of the rate hikes. Having said that, Westpac is the only major bank that's probably put rate hikes across key accounts, and they actually lifted up one by more than 0.55. CBA, not good at all. It's kind of selecting which ones, but all eyes on CBA will be this Wednesday when dividends come out.
So best deals out there.
Okay, so the best deals, Carl, you're looking at probably Macquarie. Macquarie was the first one to come out with a rate hike for its home loans, but also for its saving. But take care, because that is a promotional rate. It will then go down to 2.25. Westpac, you've got to meet the age brackets. ING, you've got conditions there. If you don't meet it, it goes right down to 0.05.
If we look at mortgages now, why have some fixed loan rates actually gone down?
Yeah, so this happened Friday. They've been slowly going down. Couple of reasons. One, obviously a whole lot of fixed rates are rolling off now. They want to grab these customers and come out with these good deals. The other one that I'm more interested at is what does this indicate where long-term rates are going? So bond yields have gone down. So just to make that simple, what that means, when you see fixed rates go down like 4 years, it means that rates may not be as aggressive moving forward. So here's the thing for consumers. CBA dropped theirs by 1.6%, 4.99. The average standard variable rate is around, say, 4%. It's actually not a bad deal, Ali, to lock in, but consider there are conditions with fixed rate loans, and you've got to be happy with that. Because the thing is, you could lock in at 4.99. If rates aren't as aggressive, you may find that at the end of that period, you're
there's not so much heat in the argument, is what you're saying.
Yeah, right. That's right. It's an interesting position that consumers are going to find themselves in, because it's not a bad rate, 4.99. It means that they're probably not thinking rates are going to go as high. We already had Westpac economists say that they may fall in 2024.
So what are your tips, and if you want to grow your savings, what should you be doing?
When rates are rising, it's a no-brainer. If you've got a home loan, you've got to put that saving in there, because you're paying, say, 4%. The money in there offsets your interest. It's tax-free. I mean, to invest outside of your home, you've got to make sure your returns are better. The other thing is, don't become complacent with your savings account. We talked about that. The other one is, dial up the risk. This is not for everyone. When interest rates go up, the share market isn't that great. But remember this, dollar cost averaging can reduce your volatility. And what I mean by that is, if share prices fall or unit falls, you can buy more at the lower rate. When it goes up, you buy less. So on average, you're buying in at a very cheap, you know, it's a cheaper rate. So that protects you. And like I said, CBA, Wednesday, all eyes will be on that, because it releases its full year profits. Mm. You're probably better to own the bank there than have money in the bank. The dividend's going to be better than the
interesting.
Paying.
Well, now to welcome relief this morning for shoppers, the price of some fresh fruit and veggies is beginning to fall. Fred Harrison from Richie's IGA joins us now from Melbourne. Fred, good morning to you. Nice to see you again, my friend. This has been a long time coming for shoppers. Tell us more.
Sure has. Sure has, Carl. And I think the weather's got a lot to do with it. We've seen a moderation from the rain, and the crops are now in and growing, and bring on the warm weather, because that's going to continue to help.
OK, give us a breakdown then of what products will be less expensive.
Well, we're seeing now red and green capsicum are both down a couple of dollars a kilo. That's been a good win. Zucchini's down significantly, another couple of dollars. The big one, lettuce. We're seeing lettuce pricing come back. Of course, we all remember the infamous story about lettuce getting to $12. We're seeing lettuce now starting to get back to $7, and broccoli's down a couple of dollars a kilo as well.
OK, there's some products that are going to remain stubbornly high, aren't they?
Sure, and we're seeing that with tomatoes at the moment. Tomatoes are generally a bit of a problem across the board. Beans, green beans, they're a shocker. They're up there around the $30, $40 a kilo mark. That's expensive at the moment. Sweet corn, very hard to get. But look, that'll improve as the weather maintains and the crops come through. We will see pricing. And pumpkin's going to be a good one. The new season pumpkin's starting to come through now, Jap pumpkin. So pumpkin's going to become a lot cheaper over the next few weeks.
OK,
as well.
So what's your outlook then over the next few months? Can you give shoppers out there some sort of indication on what it's going to look like? Because at the moment, everything's just flying and people are really struggling to pay the bills.
Sure. In a word, it's about the weather. Crops are in. They are growing. The warmer the soil gets, the quicker the crops grow. So barring any major disasters with rain, we should look and see produce prices continue to fall through to Christmas. So every week, they're coming down maybe $1 a box, $2 a box. It's not a lot, but hopefully by the time we get to October, November, pricing will be pretty much a lot sharper.
And a bit more of what we're seeing over your right shoulder, a beautiful morning there in Melbourne. Fred, thank you so much for your time this morning. Appreciate
Correct.
It.